I am writing this under an appreciable mental strain. Since by tonight, I shall be no more penniless, and at the end of my supply of the drug, which alone makes life endurable, I can bear the torture no longer. I shall cast myself from this garret window into the squalid street below. Do not think, from my slavery to morphine, that I am a weakling or a degenerate. When you have read these hastily scrawled pages, you may guess, though never fully realize, why it is that I must have forgetfulness or death. It was in one of the most open and least frequented parts of the broad Pacific that the packet of which I was supercargo fell a victim to the German sea rider. Fortunately, I guess, 5 days after we were taken, I managed to escape alone in a small boat. When I finally found myself adrift and free, I had but little idea of my surroundings. For uncounted days, I drifted aimlessly, and I began to despair in my solitude upon the heaving vastnesses of unbroken blue. The change happened whilst I slept. When at last I awakened, it was to discover myself half sucked into a slimy expanse of hellish black mire, which extended about me in monotonous undulations as far as I could see, and in which my boat lay grounded. I was horrified. The next morning, awakened from my slumber, I found the soil dry enough to walk upon the putrid region with ease. The odor of the fish was maddening, due to the carcasses of decaying fish and of other less describable things which I saw protruding from the nasty mud of the unending plain. Perhaps I should not hope to convey in mere words the unedible hideousness that can dwell in absolute silence and barren immensity. There was nothing within hearing and nothing in sight, save a vast reach of black dirty soil. Yet, the very completeness of the stillness and the homogeneity of the landscape oppressed me with a nauseating fear. I know not why my dreams were so wild that night. Such visions, as I had experienced, were too much for me to endure again. Though, awake and determined to sleep no more, I decided to start for the crest of the eminence. I have said the unbroken monotony of the rolling plain was a source of vague horror to me, but I think my horror was greater when I gained the summit of the mound and looked down the other side into an immeasurable pit of canyon. I felt myself on the edge of the world, peering over the rim into fathomless chaos of eternal night. Nevertheless, as the moon climbed higher in the sky, I began to see that the slopes of the valley were not quite so perpendicular as I had imagined. Urged on by an impulse which I cannot definitely analyze, I scrambled with difficulty down the rock stairway, gazing into the Stygian deeps where no light had yet penetrated. All at once my attention was captured by a vast and singular object in the middle of that abyss. The moon, now near the zenith,
shone weirdly and vividly above the towering steeps that hemmed in the chasm, revealing a system of hieroglyphics graven onto the Cyclopean monolith. I think that these things were supposed to depict men, at least a certain sort of men, though the creatures were shown disporting like fishes. Grotesque beyond all imagination, they were damnably human in general outline, despite webbed hands and feet, shockingly wide and flabby lips, glassy, bulging eyes, and other features less pleasant to recall. Awestruck at this unexpected glimpse into a past beyond the conception of the most daring anthropologist, I stood musing whereas the moon cast queer reflections of the silence channeled before me. Then, I suddenly saw it. With only a slight churning to mark its rise to the surface, the thing slid into view above the dark waters. Vast, polyphemous-like and loathsome, it darted like a stupendous monster of nightmares to the monolith about which it flung its gigantic scaly arms. I think I went mad then. I do not remember how I ended up again in the Pacific Sea. I have only a distinct recollection of a great storm. At any rate, I know that I heard the peals of thunder and other tones which nature utters only in her wildest moods. When I came out of the shadows, I was in San Francisco Hospital, brought thither by the captain of the American ship which had picked up my boat in mid-ocean. In my delirium, I said much, but found that my words have been given scant attention. Of any land uphill in the Pacific, my rescuers knew nothing. Nor did I deem it necessary to insist upon a thing which I knew they could not believe. Often I ask myself if it could not all have been a pure phantasm, a mere freak of fever, as I lay sun-stricken and raving in the open boat after my escape from the German man of war. It is especially at night that I see the thing. So now, slave to drugs, I am to end it all, having written a full account for the information or the contemptuous amusement of my fellow men.